Welcome back to Passionately Capping. Today we're going to wrestle with something related to evolution that a lot of people don't talk about. Usually when we talk about evolution, we're talking about biological evolution. So this would be the type of evolution proposed by, you know, Darwin, basically starting off, is this idea that you would have simple single-celled organisms and they would, you know, divide and become more complex, and then that would evolve all the future species that we experience here on Earth. But here's something that we don't talk about a lot is something that some people call chemical evolution. Chemical evolution is Darwin assumed the first living cell. You start with that first simple single-celled organism, which isn't really that simple. We've learned how complex that is as the decades and centuries have gone on. Okay, the century and a half has gone on. Is that it's really actually quite complex. But he assumed that first single-celled organism, and from there imagined how evolution, biological evolution, would work. But here's a pivotal question that a lot of people aren't considering, that science still can't fully explain, can't wrestle with. You know, will science be able to understand this fully in the future? Well, I don't know, who knows? Okay, but this is a huge problem right now, is chemical evolution is how you get from non-living material to living material. Because you can't just take the building blocks of life. Like, we're carbon-based life forms, okay? Built on carbon. You know, there's tons of various components and elements, molecules, etc., that make up a human body, for example. But you, even if you put together all the right stuff, okay, in just the right way, that doesn't mean that you get life. That does not make it alive. Okay, take, for example, you can take a human body that a person who has just died, okay, you take a human body and say that, you know, say that there was a rupture in something, maybe, you know, one of their organs was ruptured and start, you know, something like that, okay, that they bled out. Let's do that. Okay, there was a wound, an artery was opened and they bled out. Okay, you can't, the person's dead, you can't just seal up the artery and give, do blood donation, pump them full of a whole bunch of blood so that they have everything they need. Look, we fixed it, we fixed the body, it's fixed now, and you can't just zap the heart with an AED and expect that the heart's just going to start beating and the person's going to be alive again. Just, you can't, even if you put all the right stuff together perfectly, exactly, that does not mean that you have life. So the question, the problem, this is a scientific problem of chemical evolution, is how do you go from non-living material, even if it were possible, and wrestling with the numbers on this and the likelihood of whether or not you could even put together all the right stuff in this primordial ooze before there's any life on Earth, could you even put together all of the elements and molecules? Remember, for life to exist, you need DNA, okay? And DNA, even in a simple sense, is really complex. In a simple single-celled organism, the DNA is really complex. Would it be possible to put together the DNA correctly and to put together all the right stuff completely randomly, completely by chance, without any help from God, without any help from an intelligent designer? You know, the math on that, I think it's insane. Okay, I don't think it's possible. I mean, is it possible? It'd be one in so few of a possibility that it's even crazy to even talk about. Okay, that God has to be, you need an intelligent designer to be part of this process, who is putting things together the way that they need to be put together because they have a function, because they have a purpose. Okay, that this stuff doesn't just fall together randomly by chance. Okay, so chemical evolution is a major problem, is how do you go from non-living material to living material? And here's where science starts to really point to the need for God. Okay, that we need a first cause. We need something to start all this stuff into motion. We need an intelligent designer. All of this stuff is essential. Now, some people get really turned off by the phrase intelligent designer, and they think that we're trying to, you know, infuse creationism into like public school science classes. Okay, now do not make that mistake. That is not what we're talking about here in terms of intelligent designer. At all. It's, intelligent designer is not a creationism from a Catholic perspective, okay? When we're talking about an intelligent designer, we're saying that there needs to be a mind behind what happened in terms of the universe, okay? In terms of, say, the Big Bang explosion, which we'll get to in a future video, that you need to have an intelligent designer in terms of bringing life, okay? To go from non-living matter to living matter, to not only put the stuff together, the right stuff together, but to breathe life into that non-living material and to make it alive. That is a step that we cannot replicate and do not understand from a scientific perspective. This is where the God of the universe steps in and does his creation, okay? Where you can't, the reality is with science, we cannot explain everything. We're not going to be able to understand everything. There are going to be limits to math, to science, to what we can understand, like a black hole, okay? Before the Big Bang, like you can't even talk about before the Big Bang. We'll talk more about that much later. We'll have future videos on the Big Bang and what that means in terms of religion and all that kind of stuff. Lots to talk about there, okay? But this is a big issue for us to wrestle with. And as believers, as Catholics, it's beautiful because we can have it all come together. We can take the truths that we know from science, but we also accept the limitations that science comes with, okay? That science can't explain everything because it can't test everything. That's beyond science to be able to test everything. It's not possible to be able to do so because there's points that we can't reach into. There are singularities like the Big Bang. There are events like what's going on inside a black hole that mathematics and physics completely breaks down once we get into there. And we can play around with quantum physics, you know, all we like, but we're never going to be able to prove it in the scientific sense. Now, when we try to mess around with, you know, is there a multiverse out there? Do we need a god to explain this? Or, you know, what's going on inside a black hole? And we start playing with quantum physics and stuff like that. We're now playing with metaphysics. We're not playing with physics anymore. Like, we're starting to like pretend like we're being purely scientific and evidence-based, and we're starting to play around with spiritual concepts, philosophical ideas, okay? So metaphysics, you know, spirituality, philosophy, all of this stuff can play and can dance together and be beautiful and can be supported by the spiritual realm and supported by authentic physics, okay? So the scientific realm, etc. And it can all dance and play around, and as Catholics, we can enjoy all of it, and we can enjoy the dance and not have it be this fight between people of different perspectives or differences in ideas and have it be war. It can be beautiful for us as Catholics and be a kaleidoscope of truths that God is allowing us to discover, like a child who we're gradually learning more about the world and coming to understand some things, and it's beautiful and it's wondrous because we don't understand how it all works. And here's our Heavenly Father walking us through it like a child through the woods and pointing out how this works and that works, and our minds are being opened as we discover these things through the sciences and bring that into communication with what we know from spiritual truths and divine revelation, and we get to experience all of it in its glory and its beauty. If you enjoyed this, please subscribe to Passionately Catholic so you won't miss things that we share in the future. Special thank you goes out, as always, to our patrons, especially on Patreon, who make everything we do at Passionately Catholic possible. I wish you all God's blessings and peace, and I look forward to being in touch again very soon.